Hello everyone. Today I am going to talk about the characterization tools for biomaterials. A special note of thanks for Dr. Rajesh for helping me with the study materials. So he has helped me a lot for developing the course content. So when we think of a material structure, there are two parts of a material. One is the surface structure and the other is the bulk. The surface is the most reactive component for any material because it comes in contact with the environment, be it the environment of a biological tissue, be it environment of a chemical surrounding. But the major reaction of a material starts at the surface. So in the surface, within first few nanometers, we get around three atomic layers. Then we think of our thin film, which is basically 30 to 30 atomic layers. And up to 1 micron depth, we get actually 300 atomic layers. Till that, we mostly consider as a surface structure, beyond which the bulk structure starts. So we can understand that within first few nanometers, actually, we get the major surface active structures in a material. And as most of the biological phenomena is surface reactive, so most of the cases, the surface structure is very important, so is the surface characterization. So what are the surface properties of a biomaterial depends upon? The answer is surface chemistry or the functional groups that are present on the surface. It could be the surface charge. It could be the hydrophobicity or hydrophilicity, or how it is reacting with the water. The media surrounding the surface. So if it is in an organic solvent, it goes in some way, and if it is in an aqueous solvent, it goes in another way. So it depends upon the media surrounding the surface. The topography of the surface, which is basically average micro and nano roughness of the surface, because that also is important, because that is the availability of the exact surface area to the environment. Moreover, the micro and nano surface area is important because there the biological materials, biological cells, cellular appendages, say pseudopodia and all interact with the topography of the surface. Crystallinity of the surface or the ordered structure repetition of the surface, whether the surface is crystalline or it is amorphous, reaction with the tissue fluid, leaching of the chemical fillers or other ingredients from the surface, or protein absorption, they are important. Contaminants in the surface like the unwanted oxides, dye, even fingerprints can be important in terms of biomaterial surface property. So when we think of a surface property, these are the characteristic things we have to think of, like how kind of heterogeneity is present, whether there are oxide coatings, there are inhomogeneous distribution of atoms on the surface, whether there is some specific points from where there can be corrosion, there could be attack point for the external oxide or free radicals. There are different kind of things we have to consider in case of a surface property. So effect of environment on polymer surface. In the current figure, we can clearly see that in a biopolymer, in air where the polarization of the surface of the environment is not much, I mean until and unless there are so high voltage electrodes very nearby, mostly air doesn't work as a conductive media. So in that way, the organic group, or say the non-polarized group like CH3, is more exposed towards surface in air. But whenever it is under water, where the surface is where the media is more towards ionic or polarized or easy to conduct electrons, then the hydroxyl groups gets exposed. So we can see from the figure clearly that the orientation of the pendant groups in a polymer side chain in surface change with the media present. So how we measure the surface wettability or hydrophobicity? So to do that, we use basically the vector equation of surface properties of any material, I mean, we know that surface tension is a very important property for any surface, where it is a measure of the free surface energy of any material. So Young-Suprey's equation, basically what it does is it balances, in a, if a drop of fluid is put on a metal or a material surface, how it is distributed on the material, it gives a measure. So there are three interfaces developed when a fluid droplet or a liquid droplet is put on a surface. So this is, one is gamma SV, which is basically surface tension at the solid and vapor interface. Then there is gamma SL, which is basically surface tension at solid liquid interface. And there is gamma LV, which is basically surface tension at the liquid vapor interface. Now the gamma SV, which is basically solid vapor interface, this always try to push the droplet to get distributed over the surface, whereas the gamma LV, that is liquid vapor interface, and try to make it more push it more away from the solid surface, and the solid liquid interface try it more more the liquid to become a I would say like it may tries to make it like the droplet to be more spherical or something like that. So what happens is this equation is counterbalanced. If we counterbalance, is the angle by, so this is the angle which this surface makes with this surface, the droplets tangent. If we draw a tangent to the surface, this point through the surface of this liquid droplet, we get an angle of theta. So if we consider the cosine component of this, then we get the Young-Suprey equation, which is gamma SV equals to gamma SL plus gamma LV cos theta. So we experimentally measure this by putting a droplet on a surface and then taking images from using a using camera, and then we try to measure it using goniometer. So we measure this angle theta. Now theta in a surface where it is less than 90 degree, we consider it to be hydrophilic, and which is more than 90 degree, we consider it to be a hydrophobic surface. Sorry for this disturbance. One second, please. Yeah. So the surface characterization tool I'm going to talk about mostly are ESCA or XPS, electron spectroscopy for chemical analysis, or X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. This technique is based on Einstein's photoelectric effect phenomena, which follows the equation of B equals to H nu 1 minus H nu 2 plus phi. So B is the binding energy of a photoelectron, H is the Planck's constant, nu 1 is the frequency of the incident X-ray, and nu 2 is the frequency of the ejected electron, and phi is the work function of the surface. So what we do is we bombard a surface with a very high energy X-ray in an ultra high vacuum, so that the interfering in the air, whatever molecules are there, their electron does not create interference with the surface photoelectron, which is going to get ejected from the surface. So once this X-ray bombards the surface, the X-ray excites the photoelectrons of the surface materials. The photoelectrons' binding energy is a fundamental property, because it depends upon a specific atom which is bonded to the adjacent atom. So it is a specific kinetic property, and when the binding energy, when an electron comes out of a surface, it also comes, like, of course we know that electron has a property of both wave as well as a particle. So as a wave, it has a frequency. So what we measure is basically we put a reverse voltage gradient to the photoelectron. So the distance or the time of flight we measure, and from that, using the voltage gradient, we find out how much is the binding energy. Basically, we measure the kinetic energy. We already know the work function of the surface, and then from that we calculate what was the original binding energy. Work function basically means what is the minimal energy required for a surface electron to come out of a surface from the material. So this is basically the threshold from which the kinetic energy starts gaining. So if this h nu 1 and h nu 2 are equal, then work function is equals to the binding energy. So basically it is the minimum amount of energy required for a photoelectron to come out. So the main chemical components work function is determined from literature, and using a voltage gradient we find out the kinetic energy. Binding energy of any electron is unique, and from that information like bonding, doping, etc. can be determined. And XPS is a very sensitive tool. It is easily affected by contaminants. So here we are showing basically a schematic of how we find out how we do the XPS study. We put the X-ray photon, and from that the photoelectrons come out. From that we specifically find out the X-ray XPS surface spectrum. Now, as we have talked about XPS, so there is one more corresponding method of electron microscopy. So as in case of XPS, we apply X-ray photon and we take out the electrons out of the surface. In electron microscopy, we bombard the surface with electron beams, and when we do that, we find out different kind of electrons from the surface. So it could be secondary electron, which is used in ACM. It could be OJ electron, I have not discussed all of these kind of electrons, characteristics, X-ray, cathode luminescence, Bremsstrom. All of this I have not discussed in detail because that takes complete separate course to teach, because electron microscopy and all other spectroscopic techniques itself is a complete different course all along. So I guess in the Department of Metallurgy and Materials Research there must be a course on it. So what I can tell you is, in case of electron microscopy and spectroscopy, the major electron and material we try to find out are OJ electrons, which used in OJ electron spectroscopy. The backscatter electrons and secondary electrons are used for scanning electron microscopy. The characteristic X-ray is used for EDX measurement, and the transmitted electrons are used for TEM, and the elastic scattering is used for finding out the high resolution imaging of the electron microscopy. So to talk about the TEM, we have to understand one thing, that electron microscopy is very much similar with any form of light microscopy we use, except one thing. In case of light microscopy, we think of electromagnetic waves are basically visible photons or visible light photons, which are bombarded on a biological or a not only biological but any material surface, and from the transmission of light we find out some signature. From the reflected light we find out some specific features. In case of electron microscopy, the exact same mechanism is used, except here the bombarding material is electrons, not the light photons. So the instrumentation is also quite similar. Instead of the lens, what we use as magnetic coils, because normal optical lens basically changes or refracts the direction of the visible light. To do the same in case of a electron flow, we have to put voltage bias or voltage gradient so that the electron can be either made either the direction of the electrons can be like it can meet in a specific point, or we can just make it like it can we can focus it on a specific point. So the only difference between electron microscopy and light microscopy is this specific property. So the transmission electron microscope is view thin specimens through which electron can pass, generating a projection image. TEM is used for mostly metallic and ceramic crystalline materials, morphological imaging, as well as crystal structure information, which is basically selective area electron diffraction mode or SAED. TEM is used among other things to image the interior of cells in thin sections, the structure of protein molecules, organization of molecules in viruses and cytoskeleton filaments, and arrangement of protein molecules in cell membranes by freeze fracture and cryo-electron microscopy. So along with the imaging, the previous image basically we just show how a traditional TEM works for imaging purpose. The second one is basically the diffraction mode, where we find out the diffraction pattern. So if a crystal material is arranged in some specific set of lattice plane and an electron beam passes through it, the electron beam which passes directly parallel to it just goes unaltered. But whenever the electron beams are scattered in between the crystal lattice planes, it gets diffracted and creates this kind of spots. So this diffracted beam, we find out the angle 2 theta using Bragg's law from 2d sin theta. Here the lambda is very small because we are using electron, and from that we can find out this distance d, which is basically d is nothing but our crystal lattice plane distance. And we find out we r and l, these things we get from r is basically from the central point, the point we get, say for example this distance could be considered a r, and theta we find out using Bragg's law, we know lambda, and this l is basically camera length which we find out from the instrument. So application of this is we can find out the crystal planes of materials in a crystalline material, which is complementary to XRD, because in XRD we also find the same thing. In case of this, we find out d using this equation, lambda by d equals to r by l. In case of XRD, we've used Schirra equation. I have not discussed XRD because XRD is a complete different instrumental setup again. I am just talking about the electron microscopy. If I get time in future, if I get a class, I will talk about some major tools which I have not included here, which are XRD, NMR, magnetic characterization and electrical characterization of materials. Anyway, so to proceed, the other version of electron microscopy which is used a lot are scanning electron microscopy. So conventional scanning electron microscopy depend upon the emission of secondary electrons from the surface of specimen. So in the previous photograph we have seen that the secondary electrons come out from a little bit depth of the sample. So what it gives information is, the information it gives is analog to a stereo light microscope. I have already mentioned that an electron microscope is almost equivalent to a light microscope. In a stereo light microscope, we find out the refracted light from the surface, and from which actually we find out how the material is, how the material's surface property is. So we can, in an ACM also, we do the same, but in case of stereo zoom, we find out the features which are in the micron or millimeter order. In case of ACM, we find out in the nanometer region. So the material has to be conductive to do ACM. So most of the cases, if it's a non-conductive material, say for example a polymeric material or a polymer film on which we have done cell culture, we do dry it and coat it with metal ions like gold. We also use secondary ion mass spectroscopy to do a lot of analysis. SIMS is used for mass spectrum of the outermost 10 angstrom of a surface and provides information that is complementary to XPS. It aids in understanding of the surface composition. In case of mass spectroscopy, a surface is bombarded with a beam of accelerated ion like O2 plus, Ar plus, Xe plus, which are called primary ions, and the collision of these ions or these atoms and molecules in the surface transfers enough energy to them, and they sputter from the surface or into the vacuum. So a high energy atom or ionized atom is just bombarding on a surface, and it allows the other material which is present on the surface to get emitted out from the surface. The particles which are ejected from the surface are positive or negative ions, radicals or excited states. And then what we do is we find out the mass of the emitted secondary ions, or to more precisely to say, it is m by z or mass per charge ratio using quadrupolar time of flight analyzer. So time of flight means, so once it is emitted, and of course all these measurements are done in vacuum, so how long it is flying against a opposite voltage is applied. So using that we find out the time of flight. From that the energy of the material is analyzed, and then from that the m by z ratio is measured. Z we find out specifically by finding out the electron or the charge changing when opposite bias is applied. So if there are three electrons from a specific ion is we are getting, that means it was a negative ion with three extra charges. So we find out the mass from the energy calculation, we find out the charge, and then using that we find out the m by z ratio. We can talk about the surface topography, which is basically atomic force microscopy, which is very important in terms of any material. So what we do is, a small tip is attached to a cantilever as it encounters the material surface. So here what happens, we apply a laser and it is reflected back, and we put this cantilever on the surface. So whatever metal atoms present in this tip, it goes through this, and as it grazes through the surface, there is always an attraction or a repulsion from the surface happens, and from that the surface topography of the material is observed, because of which we can get a surface topographic map. So what happens is, the tip just rasters over the surface, and once it does through, then if there is a hump, then automatically looking at the interaction, say a repulsion of the tip happens. So the tip deflects according to its surface, and we get a change in this specific reflection beam. So this position changes, so we get accordingly a surface topography map. So here we are just talking about the traditional contact mode and non-contact mode of AFM, but it can be done through contact mode also. We can make this tip electroconductive and find out the electrical conductance map of the surface. We can make it magnetic and find out the magnetic profiling of the sample. So AFM has multiple application. If I get another chance, I was talking about the class. If I can get an extra class, I can talk about that also. So AFM is a very good and important tool to do that. Sometimes we, in a soft material, what we do, we tap it on the surface to find out the mechanical property of the surface also, because the micromechanics of many material is very important, specifically for the biological sample, as that gives us an idea what kind of chemical modification has taken place and what kind of functional group we are having on a biological material sample. So from the surface property, we can shift to the bulk property and characterization of biomaterials. While the surface characterization tools are different, bulk properties are very different. When it is implanted, the surface is continuously exposed and it is gets eroded. So the bulk property of any material is also as much important as much as the surface. So the bulk characterization attributes to the mechanical, thermal and optical properties. It includes the types of atoms or molecules, how atoms and molecules are arranged, or the microstructure, and processing of the material. So how it is processed, how it's a spatial distribution. So bulk property could be extrinsic or intrinsic properties, like say for example, stiffness of a material or type or composition, yield strength of a material which depends upon grain or crystal size, number and distribution of defects, stiffness of a polymer measured by stretching the polymer or alignment of the molecule, its thermal properties like boiling, melting, flash point, absorption or emission of light present in the surface properties too also, and magnetic susceptibility, electrical conductivity, all of these properties belong to the bulk property of the material. So bulk property, we have to understand one thing, that it involves multiple issues, like not only its chemistry but how it is processed, the processing property, whether it is porous, whether it is dense, all of these material, all of these are part of bulk properties, and all of this determines how it's going to influence the surface of a material. So stress is the mechanical force generated inside any material per unit area to counterbalance any structural deformation or strain. It is called stress. So I can give a very interesting question to you all. What is the difference between pressure and stress? Because both of them are force per unit area. And I might ask you in this same thing in the class, because it's a very interesting question. It's a conceptual question. So stress can be tensile, it can be compressive, it can be flexural or bending, which is basically we try to, like with the a beam or material, we just try to bend it to find out how much it is withstanding the bending. So what we do is basically we apply a torque or a moment, maybe the both side of the beam is fixed and we are applying a point load in between. So that is basically bending stress. Shear is against a deformation parallel to the linear major axis of the material. So if it's a normal stress, then stress is something like this, whereas in case of shear it is opposite to this. So if we are compressing or pulling a material with a force, then the normal stress is developed like this. So if it is a beam and we are trying to push it this way, then the shear comes in that way. So shear mostly we measure in between of plates or in between of planes. Fluid is the fluid surrounding any material is also known to provide shear stress. Shear gradient and shear stress is an important factor for many biomaterials, because that also helps in understanding when it is going to fail. So if we think of mechanical properties, we mostly start with the classic Hooke's law, where elastic limit is proportional to within the elastic limit, stress is directly proportional or linearly proportional to strain. So within this elastic region, we can find out that be it linear, be it volume, be it surface area, the stress is directly proportional to strain, and the constant we find out are, it could be Young's modulus, it could be bulk modulus, or it could be modulus of rigidity. So beyond this, there is a point which is called, this point is called limit of proportionality, and this point is called yield point. So limit of proportionality is till which the Hooke's law is valid. Yield point is the point up to which if we put a elastic, if we put a deformation, it can tend to come back. It is not always required, because in the plastic regime, what we believe is that the stress strain curve is not linear. Not only that, the material cannot come back to its original shape. So beyond yield point, the plastic deformation occurs. During this point, actually, the linear or the elastic regime and the plastic regime, this specific zone is there. So in this zone, the relationship between the stress and stress and strain is not linear, but still there, still yield point, a material can come back to its original shape, or the strain, when the strain is removed, if in a non-linear manner. In this region it's a linear way, here the recovery is non-linear way. Beyond yield point it is completely plastic and it might not come back to its original shape. So beyond the plastic regime, there is a regime where it starts necking, or it becomes the area becomes smaller and smaller, what we mentioned previously as ductility, and then beyond that it fails and it completely fractures. This is called fracture or failure point. So there are constants within the elastic limit which are known in literature, which are called Young's modulus, or the ratio of longitudinal stress to strain within elastic limit. Bulk modulus is the change in volumetric stress due to unit change in volumetric strain. Shear modulus, which is also called the modulus of rigidity, is the ratio of shear stress to shear strain. And Poisson's ratio is the ratio of lateral strain to longitudinal strain. So from the universal Hooke's law, if we simplify the equations, what we find out is G, which is basically shear modulus, equals to Young's modulus by 2 into 1 plus Poisson's ratio, and K, which is bulk modulus, equals to Young's modulus by 3 into 1 minus 2 gamma, which is Poisson's ratio. Stiffness is another term which is used, which is basically the stress limit till which any material or structure resists deformation. So stiffness is not only an intrinsic property of a material, but also it is related to its fabrication procedures. So how we measure the tensile stress or compressive stress is basically we cut materials in this kind of a shape, and these two ends are put inside the force measurement or units. This machine is called the universal tensile or universal testing machine, or UTM. And in between this force gauge, we measure the force while it, and it is pulled in between, so that in a constant rate of motion, so that we can find out when this material fails. Here we also do bending stress, where we put a beam in between three or two points and we apply a specific force. We can do it in 3-point or in 4-point flexure test, and we can find out the bending stress of a beam. In many cases where a material is not directly subjected to tensile or compressive stress, say for example wherever the material is subjected to flexure load, say for example a dental material, for a knee implants, knee cap, where there is a possibility that the material can go for bending, along with this test, the 3-point or 4-point flexure test is very much important. Plastic deformation, as we know, we have seen this in Hooke's law, that beyond the yield point there is a specific regime where the relation between stress and strain is not linear, but instead it follows a power law. That regime is called plastic deformation. So as the stress increases beyond a point, the response is no longer linear. The permanent or irreversible deformation, which is not recovered after the removal of the stress, happens. Within this period of time, what happens is we find out the proportional limit, or the highest point of the linear region in the stress strain curve. Plastic strain, or the strain which a material cannot recover even after the deforming stress, and the breaking stress, or the highest stress a material can withstand before it fails. So all of these points are important when we are thinking of a stress strain curve of any material.
So during this specific period of plastic regime, what happens is that, as we mentioned, that there is like a regime where the molecule starts getting rearranged in the polymer chain or in a crystal lattice. The arrangement starts changing, there is slippage between the planes, and finally beyond that the material fails, because the interaction between the chains or the interaction between the lattice planes no longer can withstand the togetherness. They just get detached. The crystal lattice planes detached from each other in a metal or a composite. In case of polymer, the chain breaks and finally the material fails. In case of a ceramic material, mostly this entire regime is absent. So as soon as it reaches its yield point, it just breaks. These specific cases where this regime is not available, this is called a fracture point, and these materials are called brittle, and this specific point is called brittle fracture point. Failure of a material, biomaterial or device are very different according to the materials. Onset of a plastic deformation, necking issue, and how it depends upon the actual breaking or testing condition. So, as a material should not undergo the permanent deformation, so we should not go beyond the yield stress. But beyond yield stress, when we are thinking of yield point or yield stress, what we do not understand is, for the polymer material based materials, in some cases metals also, there is two other deformation or there are two other failure mechanism that can also occur, which immediately we cannot find out. First is creep. Creep can occur in polymers and in metals at high temperature, which are considered as viscoelastic material. So what is creep is basically, let us think, we have a girder or say a rubber band. We pull a rubber band and it is, when we leave it, it reaches to its original shape. Now if we keep it for a very long time in stretched condition, and there is an environmental factor change, say for example there is a humidity, there is a change in temperature or something like that, after some days we find out that the rubber band, even though it was not stressed to a very long, very high amount of stress, there is a deformation. Because there is always viscous forces inside a polymer chain or a metal. So there is always, when there is a residual stress always remaining inside a material, this residual stress over a period of time can cause deformation. So when it goes, in case of a viscoelastic material, it comes back to its original shape, not always permanently, and there is always a possibility in a time dependent deformation which never comes back to its original size. So that is called creep. Mostly at high temperature metals also show the same property, and that creep property is used for many processing of materials also. Creep deformation does not occur suddenly upon the application of stress. Instead, the strain accumulates as a result of long-term stress. So a rubber band is stressed and it's kept for a long time, and we find out that it is no more at the same shape altogether. So creep strain rate typically refers to the constant rate and this second stage. So there is when we apply the stress at immediate time period, the stress and strain are proportional and it immediately comes back to its original point. But when we keep it for different time period, the strain changes. This epsilon zero, which is originally applied because of a stress, it starts changing non-linearly over a very period of time, and then finally it takes such a time when it fails. In case of fatigue, what we find, we apply stress and we just remove it. In case of creep, we do not remove it, but again we keep it for a very long period of time, and over a period of time, because of the even though there it is not completely removed or the residual stress is still there, the polymer chain starts moving from one to another apart, one by one by one, and finally it fails. On metal chains also it happens the same way. The metal crystal lattices, over a period of time it slips from one layer to another layer to another layer, and finally it fails. It's a time dependent way and it takes very long period of time. So the viscous force, when it overcomes the elastic limit, then that material fails completely. The next thing which comes to the level of our concern is fatigue failure. Fatigue is basically nothing but application of a load or of stress which is not up to the limit of failure, but in a cyclic way. So if we apply a lower amount of stress for infinite number of cycles, say very long, in a frequency dependent way, then it can go fail even at a lower stress. So in case of a stress, fatigue stress, there is a stress life called SN curve, so or called Wöhler curve. So in a fatigue testing machine, we put a material and we apply up to a very long period of time to find out the number of cycles it takes to fail. Or in case of a shear, we put the material in a specific fluid of a specific viscosity, which is related to our concern. Say for example, if we are thinking of blood and a heart valve, then the blood, the rheology or the viscous property of the fluid which is in which we are going to do the fatigue testing should be similar. And then we try to apply again and again this material in a fatigue testing machine till it fails. And using that, we find out the stress life or SN curve from which a material's property, crack growth, all this can be simulated. Hardness is a load, is basically we put a load in the indenter in contact with surface of a material for fixed time, and hardness is measured on a relative scale. So hardness, we just consider so hardness basically is a measure how much. So what we do is we put the material inside two solid loads and we expect to how it resists to the plastic deformation. So I'm sorry because my daughter is crying a little bit, so it might be a bit problematic. So resilience is the elastic energy which is stored in unit volume of a material under stress. So the area of the stress strain curve basically gives an estimate of the resilience. So fracture toughness is how much material can resist a propagation of crack, and the toughness is the energy required to deform unit volume to its breaking point. So if we consider this way, the elastic in a stress strain curve, so this much stress versus strain will give you, or the integration of this entire area will give you the energy. For the fracture toughness. So once the mechanical properties we have discussed, we go for the thermal properties of material. So the first property we are talking, the test we do is called differential scanning calorimetry. So we know that a biomaterial, when they are tested, it can undergo an exothermic reaction, it can go an endothermic reaction, it can lose its material. When we heat a material, its property changes, the crystal rearranges. So there are different kind, we put thermal signals, thermal triggers, and all of these signatures we try to measure using differential scanning calorimetry. So DSC measurement is basically measures the temperature and heat flows association with the transition in materials as a function of time and temperature in a controlled atmosphere. So we increased the temperature of a material and we measured its heat flow using calorimetry. So if there is a glass transition, there is a crystallization, there is a melting, there is a exothermic reaction or an endothermic reaction, we can find out all of this from this curve. In case of a TGA analysis or thermal gravimetric analysis, the mass of a sample is measured over time as the temperature changes. The temperature of the material is enhanced in a furnace where it is sitting on a high temperature resistive weighing machine, and the ambient environment can be according to the requirement, like whether we are trying to do it in air or in vacuum or in nitrogen. So say think of a ceramic material or a powder metallurgy implant where we have developed using some polymer as blend. So how the polymer is going to get evaporated or it is going to degrade it while the ceramic crystals or the metal crystals are formed, we can find out using thermal gravimetric analysis. So in different temperature, how the mass of the material is changing, from that we can find out at what temperature a major polymer degradation is happening. So we can step different points and we can find out how the mechanical property of the material is also changing, and using that we can select the proper binder, what kind of binder, how much loading we should do so that we can get a better structure. All of this we can find out using TGA. So the applications are thermal degradation kinetics of biomolecules, degradation of binders in ceramic biomaterials, temperature stability, sintering temperature, temperature kinetics for powder metallurgy route, all of this we can find out using that. So in the optical properties, I have not discussed much of atomic absorption spectroscopy, UV visible spectroscopy, fluorescence spectroscopy, all of this. The two properties we have discussed are mostly used for characterizing polymers and ceramic powders. So those two properties I have discussed are IR spectroscopy and Raman spectroscopy. So IR spectroscopy is a study of interaction between IR radiation and the matter. IR radiations refers broadly to that part of electromagnetic spectrum between the visible and microwave regime. So this is the IR regime which is used for the IR spectroscopy. So in principle, IR spectroscopy is related to the vibrational and rotational energy of a molecule. When the frequency of IR radiation is equal to the natural frequency of vibration, the molecule absorbs IR radiation. Absorption of IR radiation causes an excitation of molecule from a lower to a higher vibrational level, and each vibrational level is associated with the number of closely placed rotational level or degree of freedom. Therefore, the IR spectroscopy is also called the vibrational and rotational spectroscopy. So when the IR energy or the IR radiation is applied, what happens is an electron reaches to a higher vibrational rotational energy level and then it is emitted. From that, actually we find out the functional bonds or structure. So the true criteria which has to be satisfied for a molecule to be absorption for IR radiation, and the molecule should have possess the vibrational and rotational frequency, and the molecule must give rise to an asymmetric charge distribution. So there should be a change in electron polarity because of which IR energy peaks can be observed. So I have given a specific chart using IR spectroscopy, using which we can find out different kind of groups, like the carboxyl group, cyanide group, or say OH group, from which we can find out what kind of functional groups are available on the surface of a polymer, what kind of polymer chemistry we are going to get. And IR spectroscopy is mostly represented in a scale of wave number. Raman spectroscopy is a kind of corresponding opposite IR imaging, When a monochromatic radiation is incident upon a sample, the light will interact with the sample in some fashion, so it can be reflected, absorbed or scattered. It is the scattering of the radiation that occurs which gives information also about molecular structure. So Raman spectroscopy is based on scattering. The sample is irradiated with a coherent source, typically a laser, and most of the radiation is elastically scattered or Rayleigh scattering. But a small portion of the radiation which does is the inelastic scattering is called Raman scatter, which is composed of strokes and anti-strokes portion. This portion we use for Raman spectroscopy because it contains the information in which we are interested. The spectrum we use with the laser lens is a reference for the peaks are measured from the shift from the original laser right. Therefore, what we measure is the Raman shift in case of a Raman spectroscopy. The peak positions are determined by the vibrational energy associated with the bonds of the molecule of which the sample is composed, because of which the spectrum ends up looking like very similar to an IR spectrum and also interpreted similarly. However, the principle of mutual exclusive is applied, so the peaks that are IR active are somehow not active using Raman and vice versa. So the bands are emphasized in Raman spectrum are due to highly polarizable bonds like those with pi electrons. In case of IR, it is opposite, so either it should be polarized or it should have dipole moment, which actually depicts which bond will be activated in what. So in case of Raman spectra, we basically use the strokes Raman scattering and the anti-strokes Raman scattering, which means whether a material when it scatters, whether it's giving an high energy or a low energy stuff. Rayleigh scattering is elastic scattering, so the light comes with a specific energy and goes out with a specific energy. In case of stroke, the energy level changes. In one case it is up and another case it is down, because of which we find out two different wavelength shifts from which the Raman spectra is originated. So Raman spectra we have seen in case of some specific polymers, what are the characteristic signatures we find out. Application of Raman spectra of inorganic species are used for metal ligand bonds and some other vibrations are specifically active for Raman spectra. Raman study are potentially used for understanding the composition of organometallics. For organic species also it is used for finding out the functional groups. It is used for quantitative applications. Raman spectra tend to be less cluttered with peaks than infrared, so quantitative Raman spectra is also used. We also use Raman microscopy to find out the Raman signatures distributed in a specific area. Finally, we also use biological application in Raman spectroscopy. Say for example, gold nanoparticles conjugated with specific proteins or peptides are used for biosensing using ACRS spectroscopy. Here we have given an example of ACRS based mRNA detection using gold nanoparticles. We have also given a chart where we can find out the difference between Raman and IR spectroscopy. So one is absorption of light using vibrating molecules and another is scattering of light. So that is how it is working. Thank you all.